Production and distribution of City Club Forums on IdeaStream are made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.
Good evening, and welcome to the City Club of Cleveland. I'm Dan Moulthrop, Chief Executive here, and a proud member, and it's really a privilege and honor to assist with our forum tonight, a conversation that we've titled Lessons from the Bernie Revolution. From deep inside the revolution, we're fortunate to have with us former Ohio State Senator Nina Turner. So, cast your mind back for a second to April 2015. Almost 2 years ago, a socialist U.S. senator from Brooklyn, New York, who managed to find a place serving the state of Vermont, announced that he was going to run for the Democratic nomination for president. Yes, yes. He was a critic of Wall Street, of trade deals, of the influence of money in political races, and of many stances that moderate Democrats often took. He was gruff and cranky. I think that's fair.
I don't know about the cranky.
You don't know about the cranky? We'll discuss more. We'll put a little footnote there. And when he announced, very few people thought he would do more than serve as a kind of provocateur who might inject into the campaign more ideas from the progressive movement and pull the whole party to the left. A year later, however, he had won 18 primary contests and would go on to win 5 more, earning him more than 1,800 delegates. In the end, he completely upset conventional wisdom about presidential campaigns. In November of 2015, Nina Turner announced her support for Senator Sanders, surprising a great many Democrats and political watchers. She enthusiastically jumped on board the Bernie bus and began serving as a surrogate for the campaign on television and across the country. So I imagine some people in this room got to know Senator Turner from her work on that campaign. I first met Nina when she was a city council member for Ward 1, the southeast corner of our great city, Cleveland. She's a graduate of Tri-C and Cleveland State University. She's a veteran of Mayor Michael White's administration. I use the word veteran on purpose. She left council in 2008 to become a state senator, a position she held until 2014 when she ran for Secretary of State. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in a warm City Club welcome for Nina Turner.
Wow.
So, Nina, we are now about a little less than a month into the administration, the new administration, the
Trump
administration.
Only a month.
Only a month.
I'm tired already.
Many are, so I've heard. But how are, this was a, you know, the completely unexpected for many and certainly trying for many on the progressive left.
Yeah.
How are you handling this personally?
Gently. Calmly, as calm as possible. I mean, it definitely is a challenge, and my biggest challenge is to keep people encouraged. Because every time people turn on the news or they turn on the radio, it's always something negative. And there was a study, I think the Psychological Association just did a study. They did a study also in the general election that said that people were stressed out in the general election cycle itself. Because we can't forget that for both parties, they nominated two candidates that were unpopular on both sides. Mm-hmm. And a recent study has been done and people are really stressed out. And so there are already enough people in my mind talking about how bad things are or are going to be. And so there needs to be somebody to say that we've been here before, that we are a nation, imperfect nation, but a nation of progress. Mm-hmm. And that one person cannot stop that progress and that the power is in the hands of all of us as individuals. So that is my biggest challenge, is to help people see that it's not over. The sun will come out tomorrow.
It does.
Yes,
everything will be okay. It typically has every day.
Every day since.
Since, yeah.
He took the oath, yes.
It's interesting you say we have been here before.
Yeah.
And yet, all the pundits, I mean, constantly using the term, the word unprecedented to describe the way that the Trump administration is operating. But do you really believe that this is something no different than things we have been through as a nation
before?
Well,
maybe by the 21st century definition of unprecedented. But the first nine presidents owned slaves. You know, it's all relative. So when people talk to me about how bad Mr. Trump is, I say, let you understand some stuff. And that's the historian in me. And I am I got to give a plug for my institution, Cuyahoga Community College, where futures begin. Love that institution. Dr. Michael Scope, our fearless leader at the campus, and my dean, Dr. Ladner, and all of the students that are here from TRIO and all of the professionals that I work with. But, you know, we do have to teach the lessons of history. So that's why, I mean, we've been here before. When we fought the civil rights fights, people thought this would never be done. This country will never do this. We'll never be able to pull it off. So we've been here before. So from the women's rights movement to our gay and lesbian sisters and brothers being able to marry and love whom they will, we have been here before as a nation. So we know how to overcome obstacles and challenges. It is with commitment and a sense of righteous indignation, which is why Senator Bernie Sanders set this place on fire.
You sort of have this style that people can't help but clap after you speak. it's gonna be hard to get questions in. You just said that phrase, righteous indignation.
Yeah.
And I know that it was that was part of what drew you to him. I was reading an interview that you did, I think, with Salon, and you said that. That it was his righteous indignation that attracted you. And in fact, it was your husband who pointed out, this guy's got that same righteous indignation that you have.
Yes, my hubby did that, and he's here. Jeffrey Turner Sr. He did, you know, I did some things in 2014 after the election. I was approached by Ready for Hillary to ask if I would use my gift of motivation. Democrats were pretty depressed in 2014. You know, I was one of those Democrats that took the plunge and ran for statewide office. It was one of the hardest things that I've ever done politically, to travel this entire state from the rural parts that I probably would not have visited otherwise. And so I did do some things in 2014. Had no problem with that. But I just didn't feel it right here. I felt it here, but not here. And my husband said to me one day, he said, baby, do you know about this man, Bernie Sanders, Senator Bernie Sanders from Vermont? And I said, yes, I am aware of him because, you know, as somebody in the elected ministry, you have to know people, know of them. But my greatest moment about Senator Sanders before I got on the campaign was in 2010 when he stood up against the Bush tax cut extensions. And he gave a speech, I mean, on the floor of the Senate for 8.5 hours. This 70, you know, he's up there holding out for middle class people in this country. I said, wow, this is a bad dude. You know, so... But yeah, my husband, he really encouraged me. He said, baby, this is your candidate. I believe this is your guy. And so I dug a little deeper into his record and his reputation. And for somebody at the age of 21 who decided that discrimination at the University of Chicago was unacceptable, and to see photographs of him chained to an African-American woman who's on the ground, I mean, he stood up for those kinds of things. And he is not new to this. He didn't just adopt policies just because it was politically correct at the time. If you check his record, he's been doing these things for the last 40 and 50 years. So long story short, yes, right here it touched me. I took my husband's advice, because he doesn't boss me. He gave me the advice.
He's a counselor.
Yes. Right. But it was, if I had to do it all over again, knowing all the hell that I've caught, that we both have and that I continue to catch today, if I knew everything that I know now, I would still do it again, because it was the right thing to do.
When did you meet Bernie?
Oh, my God. So it wasn't a pleasant meeting. This really wasn't an encounter.
An encounter. Was he gruff? Was he cranky?
No, he wasn't cranky. Okay. Well, maybe a little. He was being himself, but it was in August of 2015, it was at the Netroots Nations Conference. Uh-huh. And at this conference, the Black Lives Matter women took over the room, you know. So it's this conference, it's going, it's a progressive conference. So we're in the main room, and Governor O'Malley is scheduled to speak. And Senator Sanders is scheduled to speak. And they are the only two presidential primary candidates that accepted the invitation. So got, you guys read between the lines. And all of a sudden, Governor O'Malley is up there speaking, and you hear this roar. And it's all mainly Black women just taking over the room, and they were Black Lives Matter. And a lot of progressive, a lot of white progressives, and you know, you can see the look on their face. What the hell is going on here, you know? Because they had a rhythm and a beat, and they just took over the room. And they started to ask, you know, Governor O'Malley questions about, you know, do Black Lives Matter? And he made the mistake of saying, all lives matter, you know? And I say mistaken that he didn't read the room. Of course, all lives matter, but Black lives have to matter. And there was a moment for him to really try to connect to these women who really took over the place. They had to reconfigure the whole main speech. So Senator Sanders comes out after that, and I'm saying to myself, Senator, I hope you were back there listening. You know, don't make the same error, but the senator was really in his own headspace and determined to say what he had come to say. Mm-hmm. And so that was really my first public encounter with Senator Sanders. Now, by that time, I had not joined the campaign or anything.
And did you meet him there?
Like, not there. I didn't get a chance to meet him there, even though he had staffers that sought me out. And they said, oh, my God, we need you. And could you join? But a few months later, I had the opportunity to be one of the keynote speakers for the Democratic National Convention's Leadership, Women's Leadership Conference. And oh my God, Cleveland, can I just tell you about, I was among the presidential candidates. I was one of the headliners. So it was Governor Lincoln Chafee, Governor O'Malley, Senator Sanders, and Secretary Clinton, and yours truly, Senator Nina Turner. So, as my husband reminded me, he said, baby, they were on the program with you. But as I spoke before Senator Sanders, and so in passing, so I had already talked to his campaign manager by then. They had already sought me out. I knew I was going to have a conversation with the senator, but we're like two ships passing in the night backstage. And he said, my team has been looking for you. I need to talk to you, as we were passing each other on the stage. And before he spoke, how smooth and slick he is, before he started his speech, he said, who wants to speak after Nina Turner?
Yeah. Right.
It was a beautiful thing.
Yeah, I know.
So
yeah.
That was my true kind of first one-on-one with the senator, if you will.
And that is certainly more charming than cranky, I would agree
with
you there. Yeah.
Yes.
We should get to some of the policy, the sort of policy implications of what happened there as he earned 13 million votes in the Democratic primary process, more than that, actually. And there was, I mean, it seems so unlikely from the outside. And I say that as somebody who was born in New York and, you know, has Jewish relatives who are very much like Bernie Sanders, like kind of like they're just, you know, they're at the Passover Seder and they're just going to tell you how it is and how wrong it is in Washington. And there's a few nods. Some of you know what I'm talking about. And it just seemed like that guy, really? Uncle, he's like Uncle Bernie, like he's going to be president? But that's how it looked from the outside. How did it feel from the inside? Could you sense that the train was going to go the distance?
Yeah, I mean, traveling all over this country, and I mean, I traveled all over this country, the feeling was there. You could feel it. It was palpable. And especially among the younger end of the millennial generation, because people forget millennials stretch from, you know, 30-year-olds are millennials too, and we always forget we only talk about the younger end of the millennials. But it was so palpable because the millennials gravitated to Senator Sanders like he was the Pied Piper. Mm-hmm. And to talk to people from, you know, Iowa or, you know, when I was in Alabama, people were just sharing their stories of pain and also the fact that they felt as though the political class, or as we call them now, the elites, had let them down. I mean, mm-hmm. I talked to a lady who's a single mother, white lady, and she has a bachelor's degree. Her fiancé has a bachelor's degree. She is a single mother, yet they only make they work jobs that make $8.50 an hour. So the sense of hopelessness that even when you follow the rules, even when you play the game right, that somehow your country has forgotten about you. And Senator Sanders tapped into that to say that you deserve better than what you have been getting. That having, you know, not having universal health care, shout out to my nurses, National Nurses United in here, but having universal health care is important. It's a right. That young people shouldn't be saddled by debt as they walk across the stage with a degree in one hand and debt in the other. He dared Americans to dream a bigger dream, and that was the attraction. So from the youngest person to the oldest person, and Dan, I met a lady in New York when I was at the Working Families Party receiving an award. She is 85 years old. She ran for office for the very first time because of Senator Bernie Sanders. And she won her race, too. Hashtag, you never too old to make a difference. So, yeah.
Race played out during the campaign in interesting ways. You started talking about the Black Lives Matter movement, how they took over that Netroots conference. And there were moments that were very difficult to manage for white candidates who, like Martin O'Malley, like Governor O'Malley, saying all lives matter. And there was a moment, too, when I believe Secretary Clinton found her microphone getting sort of taken over by people on stage. Mm-hmm. And I think Senator Sanders had a similar...
He did. He was in Washington State.
Yeah.
But he stepped back. And even though I don't agree with the way the young ladies approached him, because I would never do that to an elder, especially, to just take over like that. He let them take over. He stepped back and he listened to what they had to say. He didn't try to dictate to them what they had to say. He listened to what they had to say. But yeah, that was happening all over the country.
The moment you just described seemed like it was a critical moment for the campaign to gain some bit of credibility with black citizens.
In some ways, I mean, the senator was running from behind in that regard. I mean, being someone from Vermont, with 600,000 people, I think, in the entire state, and the state is not, you know, it's about 95-97% white. Mm-hmm. So, and he didn't have the benefit of a national profile, and Secretary Clinton had the benefit of a national profile for a very long time. So in many ways, you know, he announced in April 2015, he was really trying to play catch up and really to introduce himself to the citizens of this country.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Did Senator Sanders believe he could win?
Yes, he did.
The whole time?
Most of the time.
Uh-huh.
I mean, but you don't run. I mean, whenever you run a race, you know the odds. I mean, he knew very clearly. Let me rephrase that. He knew that the mountain that he had to surmount was high. But you never run for office if you don't believe that you can win. And when he started to penetrate in Iowa and New Hampshire, you know, those early states, mm-hmm. and he saw the turnout of people who really were not necessarily Democrats, but they were attracted to his righteous indignation about what the wealthiest country on the face of the earth could do for everyday people.
Mm-hmm.
And that started to turn the tide. And even his fundraising, right? The average donation was
$27. I know.
So people started to donate. And so that energy started to pick up. You know, it's almost like a train. When once you get going, baby, you can't stop the train. And that is what was happening for Senator Sanders. So, yes, he did believe, because he believed that if he spoke to the hearts of the people, that they would rise up. And that's exactly what folks did, because he proved that you don't have to take big money from Wall Street and millionaires and billionaires. And it's not that all millionaires and billionaires are bad, because we need good philanthropists in our life. Yes, we do. But we need also millionaires and billionaires to understand that to whom much is given, much is required, and that they have an obligation to society, and not to say that they have more voice, which Citizens United did to us in this country. Mm-hmm. So they can't have it all, as Senator Sanders says.
In the end, Senator Sanders did not secure the nomination.
No.
Secretary Clinton did. And we all sort of watched the general election and its outcome. How were you feeling in, you know, in between the convention after the convention, once we sort of settled into August, September, October, this kind of the rhythm of the general election campaign, how did you view all of that?
It was hard because a lot of the Bernie-crats were treated with such disdain and disrespect at the convention. And it wasn't what you all saw on TV. I mean, I was behind the scenes. My husband was there with me. And it wasn't even, you know, even I was treated terribly. Senator Sanders wanted me, along with Councilwoman Tulsi Gabbard, to put his name in nomination. And even though the senator, you know, said, I'm going to support Secretary Clinton, and he did all of that, I was not allowed. They would not allow him to have me for 2 minutes put his name in nomination. They wouldn't even allow a video to be shown with my image in it. That's how nasty it had gotten. So I was very heavy because I am a public servant. That is what I do. And I believe that my job is to lift people and to motivate them and to push them. So whether I'm in a classroom or I'm just talking to somebody in the grocery store, I want them to know that they have everything within them to make this world a better place, but more importantly, that they count, that they matter, that titles are good, but purpose is better. You don't have to have a fancy title to make a difference in this world and to lift people and to make them feel good. So for that to happen to me was very, very hurtful because I had been a stellar Democrat in very good standing. And I thank God for not only the National Nurses United, led by Rosario Dawson, my girlfriend, my sister girl, Councilwoman Tara Mosley Sample from Akron. I had an activist, Portia, from the southern part of Ohio. And I named some of these names because that next day, they took over the media tent for me. And no one had ever done anything like that. The grassroots to the grass tops in terms of activists, actors like Danny Glover and Susan Sarandon and Rosario Dawson and Shailene Woodley to everyday people took over a media tent for me because they felt as though I had been disrespected and had received treatment that I did not deserve. But that moment was bigger than me because there were so many Bernie-crats from all over this country who were mistreated. And so you can't mistreat people and then expect them to show up and vote. You just can't do that. And that's really what happened there. So yes, I was, you know, this was a non-establishment election year. 2016 was that. And the Democrats didn't get it. And we lost. And Mr. Trump won.
You serve on the Democratic National Committee?
I do.
What's going on?
Well, we will be voting for new leadership at the end of this month on the 25th of February. We'll be in Atlanta to vote in there.
This has been going on a while, too.
For a while, yeah.
Is it, this sort of thing, you kind of imagine that it would happen a little more quickly, but I mean, they can change over the prime minister in England like 4 times before we get even like a DNC chair.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just a timing thing. But what are the dynamics inside these meetings, and what's going to carry the day?
Well, there are two front runners, even though there are lots of candidates, and one is Congressman Keith Ellison, who I support, and Labor Secretary Perez. And it's going to be intense because there are 447 people that they have to lobby for. The leadership of the DNC rests in the decision of 447 people. And most of those people are party insiders. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens. Some people
do most
see
of them
this.
Have like a candidate they're already backing? I mean, I can't imagine most, there are too many
most
undecideds.
Most of them do. Most of them do. And this is turning out in some circles to be a proxy war, as much as I think both Congressman Ellison and also Secretary Perez are trying not to make it a proxy war, but it is turning out to be Sanders versus Clinton.
Is that right?
Whose side are you on? Mm-hmm. You know, so it's going to be hot. I will be there. Hotlanta. Atlanta's going to be Hotlanta, sure enough.
What do those two directions mean for the party? What would Thomas Perez do that you think wouldn't be good for the party?
Well, you know, I don't want to say so much what he wouldn't do, but I'll tell you what I'm looking for and why I'm supporting Congressman Keith Ellison is that we need somebody who understands that everyday people matter. Mm-hmm. that we cannot be a party both of the wealthy and affluent in terms that they have more voice than everyday people, that we need a 50-state strategy, that the President Obama had imposed a rule on the DNC that the DNC would not take money from lobbyists, and Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz overturned that. And it's not so much that wealthy people are bad, because I think Democrats kind of get into that where we're labeled as the party that says that all wealthy people are bad. It's not that all wealthy people are bad, but you cannot be a party of the people, but yet let folks who have the most money overshadow the voices of everyday people. So I want to see somebody that understands that the voices of the everyday people, that mama, that father, that grandmother, that student, that those voices matter, that person in the House of Labor, that their voice matters just as much as the billionaire donor. That you do need money for the mission. You do need people to sow the seeds, but you cannot be the party that says on one hand you're against Citizens United. Meanwhile, within your party, the wealthy control everything.
Is the billionaire donor involved in the decision? Like, are they contributing to these inside the party, intra-party campaigns?
For some, absolutely.
Is that right?
So we'll see. I think the Democratic Party has 2 good years to get its act together. And if it does not, if we don't seize this moment, never let a good crisis go to waste. If we don't seize this moment, the Democratic Party as we know it will cease to exist, because people just are fed up. I see #DemExit everywhere I go. Millennials are over it. They're not really connected necessarily to a party. They are attracted to a personality that says that you matter too. And if the Democratic Party does not go back to its working class roots, a party that stands up for the downtrodden in this country, they should watch out.
You just said something really interesting that about attraction to a personality.
Yeah.
Do you fear that, I mean, as much as that can, it depends on the personality in a lot of ways, but that is, it's not about policy then, it's just about personality. No matter what the policy implications.
True that.
There's a tension there.
No, you're right. But very few people vote based on your policy. You know, Democrats are very cerebral. People,
that makes me so sad.
People vote, but people vote right here because you touch them right here. And it's your actions through the force of public policy, through the force of that office that will get them. You know, I had a chance to talk to Councilman Polinzik. And he was talking about the election, and he was so upset. He said, my constituents...
I can't imagine him upset.
I know, right? But he said, what the Democrats were talking about in 2016 did not appeal to my constituents. They want to live in safe neighborhoods. They want to know that children can go to good schools. He said, my elders in their communities want to be able to sit out on their porch in peace. He said, meanwhile, the Democrats were talking about how great they were, and they lost sight of the needs of the people. So personality is part of it, but ultimately when you elect that person, they have to deliver. Mm-hmm. And that is what people are looking for. They're looking for somebody that is actually going to deliver. But this is the point. He also said in some ways, and as much as I know this may pain people to hear this, he said in some ways the people who voted for Mr. Trump were voting for a different type of hope, which is we have been messed over by the establishment so long that we hope that somebody else will do things a different way. And we're willing to forego all of the character flaws for something new and something different. And I thought that was a powerful statement.
It was kind of a gamble.
Yeah.
In that way that something new and something different.
Well, they gambled.
Would be, yeah.
Yeah.
We have. Back to Congressman Ellison for a moment.
Yeah.
The big critique that he's been facing has to do with remarks in the past in support of the Nation of Islam. Is that going to ultimately, is he going to be able to get past that?
I think he can. I mean, Congressman Ellison is not, he's not anti-Semitic whatsoever, and he will be able to overcome that. I mean, he was younger then, and, you know, he's a Sunni Muslim. My father, who is here, is a Sunni Muslim as well. And we cannot be divided like that based on that. Judge the heart of the man and the work that he has done up until this point. So I don't think that one incident I think he was in college.
Yeah.
When that happened. I don't think
I don't want anyone to know what I did in college.
I know, right? Did you go to Cuyahoga Community College?
I did not.
You did? Okay.
I did not go to Tri-C. Yeah, it might have gone better for me had I started my future there.
That's right.
There is, we're going to get to questions from all of you in a second, but I wanted to note that a couple of days ago, I was doing my research, reminding myself of all of the many things that you've been involved in, and then I found a Twitter account attempting to draft you for the 2020 race.
Right. I see Mr. Polk shaking his head. Can I just say, Mr. Polk is a Republican. But he has given me so much good counsel over the years, especially when I started off in Cleveland City Council. And I hope that one of the lessons that we learn is that we should not allow people to divide us based on some artificial political affiliation.
I agree.
We really are stronger together, and we got to bridge the divide across. It really is about people of good consciousness. And while I'm there, so Dan sends me this screenshot. He said, "Did you know about this?" And I said, "No, I did not know."
Says, yeah, it's like at Nina for 2020.
Yeah, 2020. Oh yeah. My God.
And there's another effort to draft you to run for governor in 18. Yeah,
I'm just. I'm humbled. I'm humbled.
So do you have a? Announcement you want to make? No. Anything? No? We love to make news when we can.
I know. Okay. I'm here to announce that I'm going to continue to work very hard doing what I do.
Teaching another semester
at
Tri-C.
At the Tri-C, where futures begin.
Futures begin there. That's what we've heard. All right. So you heard it here first. There's no announcement tonight.
Not tonight.
Yeah. But we're not. We're not ruling out anything. No. I mean, all options are always on the table, aren't they? Yeah. Tonight we are enjoying a forum with former Ohio State Senator and Bernie Sanders surrogate Nina Turner. We're about to begin the audience Q&A. We welcome questions from everyone: City Club members, guests, students, those of you joining us via our webcast. If you'd like to tweet a question, please tweet it at the City Club, and our staff will work it into the program. We do want to remind you that your questions ought to be brief and to the point, so we can hear. I try to keep my questions as short as possible. You have a lot to say. It's okay. It's good. Holding our microphones today are our content coordinator Teddy Eisenberg and our director of programming Stephanie Jansky. May we have our first question, please? Go ahead. Please stand up to ask your question too, so the cameras can spot you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My question is, what do you think the outcome on Obamacare will be like since Trump is in office now?
Well, you know, our Republican colleagues have been trying to repeal the Affordable Care Act for the last 6 years. They don't have a replacement. We got about 20 million people, 30 depending on what figures you look at, that their lives will be torn asunder because the basic, you gotta have health care. So President Trump has assured the nation that he is not going to repeal without a replacement and that the replacement is going to be big, believe me. It's gonna be much better than before. But seriously, they are slowing it down. I mean, I think I heard President Trump say on an interview that nothing may happen until 2018 because what Republicans are hearing all across the country from their own constituents is that you should not, it's irresponsible to snatch this away without a replacement. And President Trump, I hope, will live up to what he said on the campaign trail, which was he was going to make it bigger and better. And remember, even President Obama said that he would welcome something that enhances, that takes this to the next level. And that's why I really do believe that we need Medicare for all in this country.
Hi, Nina.
Hi.
Nurses for Nina. we're ready. We got our bus in the wash.
Thank you.
I really just want to say, you know, you started out with there's so much negativity and divisiveness right now. What advice would you give to people who really want to build on the Bernie movement and move forward about organizing around solutions and the vision for the future and how we engage other folks?
Thank you for that. I mean, find a cause that you believe in or a candidate that you believe in. If we continue to be, some people are depressed. Everybody's not depressed. I mean, we got to be realistic about this. Some folks are happy they got the electoral outcome that they wanted. But you have to find a cause that you believe in and fight for that cause. And it doesn't have to, it can be something as big as Medicare for All. It can be something as huge as fighting against Citizens United for the future to try to get, you know, that, an amendment to the Constitution. Or it can be adopting a student at a school and tutoring them on for English or math or science or history. It doesn't have to, it's whatever your heart desires, as long as, you know, Reverend Dr. King said, only darkness can't do away with darkness, only light can. And we have to try to find the light. And hopefully the awakening that people are feeling right now will never, ever go away. Hashtag stay woke. So find a cause or find a candidate or just find something that gives you joy, but don't allow people. It's one thing to be cognizant of the realities of what losing did, because race, politics, losing has consequences. And we're feeling that. But what are the collective we going to do in 2017 on the local level, in 2018 on the state level, and 2019, because there's no such thing as an off-year election. Every single election cycle, there's somebody or something on the ballot. And my God, what are we going to do in 2020? We've lost over 1,000, well, I'm saying we. Democrats have lost over 1,000 seats, both on the state level and the federal level, since 2009. You know why? Because we took our eye off the ball and we were celebrating and we lost sight of what we're really elected for. People are elected to office to serve. And once they see serving and understanding why they are there, then we really don't need them. So this loss didn't occur just because of Mr. Trump. The loss occurred because Democrats have lost their way for a very long time, and we have to find our way back. Or as Denzel Washington said in The Great Debaters, I am here to help you find your righteous mind. So hopefully we will find our righteous mind.
Would you say a word? You lost your first run for office.
I did, for Cleveland City Council.
I know.
Dan, why you gotta...
Because I want you to say something right now. There's a lot of people who are fired up and are now running for office as a result.
Yes, thank God.
And not all of them will win.
No. But even in losing, there are lessons. You may have lost the race, but you're not a loser. Mm-hmm. And you can learn so much from that. I ran for city council, and the very first time I did lose my race, I went and got counsel. I did. But I had to study myself and determine what was I going to do next. Was this for me? And whether or not I was going to run again. And I ran again 4 years later, and I won. So it can happen. I know people who run over and over and over again. There's one judge that just won, Judge Midday. And I know she ran at least two or three times, and bam, she got it this time. Mm-hmm. So you can't give up. Losing doesn't mean that you are a loser. It doesn't mean that you weren't the best candidate. It just meant for that moment, you didn't penetrate. You didn't get enough votes. But if it's something that you are hungry for and something that you want, and you believe that you are best suited for that position, run again, keep running, and run some more until you wear out or until you get the seat. Yeah.
We got a question right over here.
Yes. Hi. One of the things that our so-called president said, mostly in the fall,
now,
was that the election was rigged, and he turned out to be true. So I just wondered, in terms of the decades Republicans have spent rigging elections and sense of voter suppression, election fraud, and the gerrymandering, what are the Democrats going to do to enact some changes to the systemic problems that we have in getting elected?
Yeah, gerrymandering is a problem. I mean, but both parties do it. The Republicans tend to have been a little more vicious with it. I think that has a lot to do with the technological advancement so that you can surgically decide. But both parties do it. Because let's be honest here, politics is about power, who has it and how they wield it. What Democrats are going to have to do is win elections. We got to win so that in 2020, when it's time to redraw lines, we are ready. But we got to keep up the redistricting fight. There are a lot of court cases going on across this country. And Republicans have been losing those court cases because the court system has been able to see through how that gerrymandering negatively impacts the people, the citizens, and not the elected officials. So They got to win elections and have the pen, but you got to keep fighting for that. You know, there's an African proverb that says that one should never build their shield on the battlefield. Well, it's shield building time, and you can't wait. You got to, Democrats have to plan right now. But even bigger than that, especially for statewide offices, we need to start to speak to the hearts of the people. Because for statewide office, it's not about gerrymandering. You know, it is really about how you get out there and really push for the people. Now, money has something to do with it, too, so I'm not trying to make this simplistic. But Democrats really do have to rethink who they're serving and why they're there. Now, in terms of rigging, we do know that the Russians played a hand, but what the Russians didn't vote. I mean, nobody has said that they voted. And so some of the Bernie-crats feel like it was rigged, too, you know, in the primary against Senator Bernie Sanders. So we got to kind of be careful with that. And that's why we need people of good consciousness. We need both parties. We need credible, conscious-minded people in both parties who actually care, who understand that people shouldn't draw lines for the convenience of elected officials. This should be about the convenience of the citizens. And we as a nation have gotten away from that because we have elected officials, both Republicans and Democrats, who believe that they own these seats. And they don't. It's
complicated. Again, it's complicated in Ohio because the people with the power to affect change on redistricting, which sounds like where you were going.
Yes.
Are state legislators.
Yes.
And even the Secretary of State, he's got a voice, but he doesn't have a say in it.
Not for the congressional.
Not for the congressional districts.
Yeah. Right, absolutely. I mean, but that's why elections have consequences. So if we want to be able to push policy, then we got to get folks elected to office. And that means that you got to help people win with all your might. But it's called running for office for a reason. Every year, you need to win over the people and not the other way around. I kind of got the feeling in 2016, I don't know about the rest of you guys, that something was owed to somebody. And that just it didn't make me feel good. Yeah.
Welcome home.
Thank you.
You enjoy justified love and admiration, but you also have constructive critics.
Yes.
How do you answer the fundamental question whether your candidate, Bernie Sanders, your active support of him and the people who joined you help elect President Trump?
Wow, that's a good question. I answer that as no, they did not. They did not. I mean, they did not. There were many Bernie-crats along the way that said that if the senator was not the nominee, that they would vote for Secretary Clinton. But she lost the Electoral College, and that really does not have anything to do with Bernie-crats. That has something to do about a country that was not willing to put in an establishment candidate, that the mood of the country was that of disruption, and that the people spoke, and they spoke in a different language. I mean, just in our state alone, President Trump won 70% of the vote in 30 counties. And we know how important Ohio is because no Republican has ever won the presidency without the great state of Ohio. And he won the state by double digits. And even in Youngstown, that is almost a majority African-American city, he almost won that city. So what are you saying, Senator Turner? This is what I am saying, that it is the job of the elected official, the person that is running, to win over the voters and not the other way around. And that just did not happen in this country in 2016. Mm-hmm.
I feel like that was a very Mike Michelson kind of question, though. So
I know. Yeah, yeah. That was, ooh.
Yeah. Mm. So, that's what the City Club does. Yes. Go ahead.
Hi, Nina.
Hi.
I wore my one and only wrap dress.
Oh, you did.
There's a group out of California that started Wrap Dress Nation.
For me?
Yeah, for you.
I love that. Yeah. I almost wore my wrap dress tonight.
So, no pantsuit for me. Wrap dress, thank you. I'm tired of labels. Yeah. I do see myself as a Bernie-crat. I don't want to be called affiliated with any party. Yeah. I Dem-exited. I voted Green. Devastated by what's happening right now. I don't know how many of us can trust the current Democratic leadership. And I feel at a crossroads right now when obviously working outside the two main parties failed miserably. And how do we convert, transform the Democratic Party, and at what point do we realize that that is going to be a failure and we work towards building a new party? I feel like many of us are at a crossroads right now and don't know where to go with this. And it doesn't sound hopeful when you watch what's happening in the Democratic Party right now either.
Well, thank you for that. I don't want to label it a failure just yet. We got to give it a chance. And with new leadership comes new opportunity. And that's why I say two good years, but you may give them three, some other people may give them four, and other folks may give the Democratic Party a lifetime. But you can't let a good crisis go to waste. And the Democrats have to do some soul searching because Democrats lost. And that's important to know. But what Democrats have to do is first confess our sins. We lost. Also recognize that there are people hurting in this country. I think Reverend Jackson put it the best. He said that we have to deal with class and caste together. And we failed to do that as a party. If the Democratic Party is one willing to admit, notwithstanding, we know that the Russians did some things, and I'm not excusing that, but the email reveal, the Russians didn't write. So we have to admit that some things went wrong in the primary and correct that. And the next leader of the Democratic Party has to say that what happened to Senator Bernie Sanders in that primary will never, ever happen to anybody else, whether they're running for dog catcher or they're running for president of the United States. And I also think they got a clean house from top to bottom. Yeah. From top to bottom. Everybody needs to go. And they got to start fresh because we got to win back our integrity. See, this is not just about, this is not about Senator Sanders. This is about the integrity of an organization, an institution known as the Democratic Party. And we have lost our integrity. And to your point, not only people like you, but there are a lot of millennials who are not, they don't want to be affiliated with a party for that reason. So we got a lot of work to do. But don't, it's not a failure. And please, I don't want you to lose hope. Don't lose hope. Hi.
Do you believe that Bernie Sanders' message was primarily an economic one? What struck me the most about his candidacy and watching him in the media and on television was his remarkable message discipline. Yeah. He would always drag the interviewer or drag the discussion back to what he called the central issue, the raw deal that the American people were getting that he talked about. It's his phrase. Do you believe that his campaign, his movement, and sort of his ideas are centrally an economic message?
Economic and moral. Because there's a certain moral undergirding to what Senator Sanders was pushing and leaders like me about how can you live in the wealthiest nation on the face of the earth but not provide universal health care? How can you live in the wealthiest nation on the earth and be okay with young people being saddled with debt in one hand and a degree in the other? How can you live in the wealthiest nation on the face of the earth knowing that in America we pay more for pharmaceuticals, you know, than anybody else in the industrialized world? How can you live in the wealthiest, most successful nation on the face of the earth and have about 2.2 million people in prison and almost half of them be black folks, black males, black and brown, and poor people, and say that justice is all right? So yes, it was an economic message, but it was a moral message as well. And that is why he was able to win over the hearts and minds of so many people across this country.
Senator Turner, I was just wondering what your opinion is on organizations like Brand New Congress and Justice Democrats in regards to the midterm elections and building the grassroots movement?
Oh my God, I think it's good. Bring it on, bring it on, bring it on. You know, nothing shakes up politicians like folks coming in saying we will challenge you if you don't live up to what you said. I mean, I call me old-fashioned, but I just happen to think that when politicians run for office and make certain promises, that they need to adhere to those promises. I mean, you running for the people, and so I love the new Congress, Justice Democrats. Bring it on. Let's shake this whole thing up.
Hi, Senator Turner. Hi. My name is Roger Sykes, and there's a proposal on the table in Cuyahoga County to give about $160 million to Dan Gilbert and the Q. There's recently been, with the Greater Cleveland Congregations and the Cuyahoga County Progressive Caucus, organizing around a community equity agreement and pushing back against that taxpayer giveaway. So I was curious your perspective on that issue.
Well, first of all, I applaud the Progressive Caucus and also Greater Cleveland Congregations. There needs to be a pushback on that. You cannot just give it all away to the Cavs organization and then leave people languishing in the community. It's just not right. And the taxpayers are paying for this. And many of the people paying for this can't even afford to go to any of the games. And so there has to be some give and take. There has to be partnership. So if we can get that agreement, then that's a good thing. If we can't get that agreement, then that needs to be... We always have enough money for what we want, but never enough money for what we need. And there are lots of needs in the community that have to be addressed. So I applaud the efforts to shake that up as well. So thank you, Progressive the Cuyahoga County Progressive Caucus and Greater Cleveland Congregations.
Hi, thank you so much for coming here today. What I've heard from state Democrats, including my representative at the state house, is that there's just no way for Democrats to win back the state to the two legislative houses at the state level in 2018. On the other hand, I think that the 2016 election showed us that polls weren't working the way we thought they were and that there's a lot of movement happening in this country. I wonder what your take is on what's possible in 2018 for the at the legislative level and here in Ohio.
Yeah, thank you for that. I mean, I'm kind of disheartened that folks would say there's just no way. I mean, folks thought it was no way that Mr. Trump would be president of the United States of America, and here we are. So, you know, in the age of Trump, where there's a will, there is a way. So we got to get out there and fight to win these seats. The best way to eat an elephant is one bite at a time, if you got to eat one at all, but just one bite at a time. So we got to do this cycle by cycle. But it troubles me that leaders would say there's just no way, because then why even try? We lost seat. There were 10 Democrats in the Senate when I was there. Now there are 9. We lost House seat or two. We have to gain back those seats that we lost, and we need to do it cycle by cycle. So my recommendation to the Democrats is to have a cycle by cycle strategy. And I also believe that too much focus was on the national election and not enough focus on our own backyard, which is we should have never lost a Senate seat and we should have never lost any House seats. You got to hold. Even if you can't gain, you shouldn't lose. But leaders are visionary. Now, you got to be practical and honest, but you also have to be a visionary. So to say that there's just no way, we need to rethink that kind of leadership. Now, it's all right to say it's going to be hard and difficult. But for a leader to say that there is no way, that makes me a little disappointed.
Are you, to that point, are you worried about the state of the Ohio Democratic Party? The Democratic Party has a single statewide office holder right now.
In some ways, I mean, the Ohio Democratic Party, though, is doing some great things. I mean, we have a Main Street program where we go out and try to really recruit up-and-comers, and not just based on age, but also based on, are you hungry enough to run? We need you to run. But we really do have to take stock in what happened in 2016, not just on the national level, but here in the state of Ohio, what happened in 2014. And we can't always be the party to say that the tsunami took us over and so we just keep losing. There's something wrong and we need to address it. So yeah, concerned, yes. Hopeful, yes.
Yeah. Hello.
Hi.
I can't tell you how much I appreciated seeing you living in another country. I left the U.S. in about 2004.
Where do you live? In Australia?
I was living in Austria.
Austria.
And I was touring as a musician, so it was really nice seeing you on international news.
Now, you're an opera singer, correct?
That's one of them, yeah.
Yes.
But After seeing the United States from the other side, how do you feel about the, I have to look at, the Problem Solvers Caucus? Instead of it being one side Democrat, one side Republican,
yeah.
Is there a way after the fighting for the past 10 years that they can come to some sort of agreement?
The Problem Solvers Caucus, Dan, I like that.
That's nice.
She's writing it down. I had a chance during the convention, which wasn't all bad. I mean, I met so many good people, but there was a group, I think it was the People's Summit, and they had a conference, but their conference was omnipartisan. And I thought, how enlightening was that, to have omnipartisan way of dealing with healthcare and education and economics and criminal justice. So everybody, Libertarian, Green Party, No Party, Republican, Democrat, came together. So I like what you're saying, a problem-solving caucus. It's a good idea. It's a good idea. Love it.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, yeah. We are at the end of our program.
Already.
Tonight at the City Club of Cleveland, we've been enjoying a forum with former Ohio State Senator and Bernie Sanders surrogate Nina Turner. Tonight's forum is the Mike Michelson special program. We extend a special thanks to Bob Belenker and Art Brooks for their dedication to the establishment of this memorial forum.
Yes.
And we are also pleased that friends and family of Mike Michelson could be with us tonight, including Mike's daughter Eve Michelson Bianco and her children Alexandra and Yellow Bianco, who are watching from New York. And we thank all of you for your support and your presence tonight. It's also the Aaron H. and Ruth S. Zychek Memorial Forum, made possible by a generous gift from their estates. Nephew Lawrence Zychek is with us tonight. We thank you very much for your support as well. Additionally, yes, please. Thank you. And we welcome guests at tables hosted by the ACLU of Ohio, the National Nurses United, Cuyahoga Community College, the Cuyahoga County Progressive Caucus, and also students and their parents from the Flow Homeschool Co-op. We thank all of you for being here. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I thank you, Senator Turner. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. Our forum is adjourned.
For information on upcoming speakers or for podcasts of the City Club, go to cityclub.org.
Production and distribution of City Club forums on IdeaStream are made possible by the generous support of PNC and the Raskin Family Fund, with additional funding from Cleveland State University, Robert Conrad, and the Payne Fund.